And the title of this conference, Our Common Present and the Evolution Towards the First Report of Sustainable Development, Our Common Future, made me think about what are we doing in our educational programs, which I'm going to present today. And we are actually confusing or playing with the dimensions, because what I'm doing is I'm working as a research educator at the University of Munich Technical One. So I teach science teachers to be good science teachers, and my specialty is to take them out. We have a student research center owned by the university, brand new, in Berchtesgaden, which is a mountain resort just 2 hours southwest, southeast of Munich. And it was created as a training center for youngsters from 5 to 18 to learn all about science. And it is located in the middle of the mountains at a national park, actually where there are woods. Not so many, but they are seen. And one of our colleagues is one of the wolf specialists in Germany. So, a connection here. And so I thought, we cannot stay inside the building, in the laboratory, looking out of the window and seeing all those mountains and never go there. So I was thinking of, well, take the children out. Take them on research expeditions, real expeditions, into the national park. And to fit this in the German school system, I designed it as a residential course. So the pupils from the schools, from Düsseldorf or Heidelberg or from the big cities, come by coach for a week. They come on Sunday, they leave on Friday. And if we have good teachers cooperating, they come prepared. If they have bad teachers, they come unprepared. So we check the children on Sunday, are they prepared or not, and then decide on a program. We have two versions. On a prepared version, we can skip the Monday part and go on an expedition for 3 days. And if they come unprepared, which they mostly do, we have the full Monday after, you know, getting acquainted with the peak, with everything, for introducing the children into their tasks of the researchers. So, and we take the children up on an elevation of more than 1,000 meters. 1,000 meters? So from the valley to, not the top, but to the glacier, and down again. And what we have is a 2 degrees Celsius temperature shift from the valley to the top and down. And what we can do here is we can project the presence into the future. Because on the way down, the temperature, the annual average temperature, becomes 2 degrees warmer. And if we do the right observations, we can observe what happens with 2 degrees temperature shift from now to the future. So actually, we let the children go down into future. And this idea was kind of, you know, the basis of what I was trying to establish. Because, you know, if we tell the children it's going to be 2 degrees warmer in the future, they do not understand it. They need a bodily experience or very plastic aesthetic experience what that means. We cannot ship every German school children to Indonesia to see the floods and experience that physically. And if we carry that into our floods we have, they have nothing to do with climate change. That's what the politicians tell us. So we need some sort of didactics of making this physically experiential. And this is what I have become sort of a specialist in, or specialized in my research with my team. So the thematic scheme of our programs is eco-climatology. It is eco for ecosystem. And maybe you are familiar with the Greek word root of oikos. It means house, but not the physical house. It means the whole sociology of a house in the ancient Greek, including the master, the women, and the slaves. So it's all people in that house. So it is not only plants and trees and animals and some chemistry, it's also us human beings. And it has to do with climate. We want to learn something about climate and teach something about climate. And we use the space for time approach, which is actually a common approach in biology, in phenology research, which has to do with measuring the offspring days of flowers in spring, and measure the period of blooming. So, and the offset dates of flowers is a very good indicator for climate change. And once you go up in elevation, you can see the shift even more drastically, because the alpine regions are much more prone to react on climate change effects. So that's a little trick we use, making use of the surroundings of the high alpine area our center is located. So what we do is, when we go up, we measure all kinds of phenological data. So we split the children into two groups. Say they come with 30 people, students, and their teachers. We split them into four groups. Two groups are doing botany, two groups are doing other stuff. And we can actually split those two groups, the 15, into even three or two groups, because we use my students. I bring in students into those courses so that the students can learn how to teach properly. And so we can actually have 3 to 4 children together with one grown-up assisting them during the research process, and actually also taking care of them in the mountains, because you know, you get them out in the mountains, it's difficult terrain sometimes. So we have those alpine trained people in small groups. You don't want to have 30 people in a row going up the mountain, it takes a kilometer. So we have those very effective cells. So one group, the botanists, learn everything how to detect their plants, so they are assigned up one plant or two, and they're now in the lab on the Monday, they're preparing, they learn the little details and how to detect their plants, because what they're going to see, depending on the time of the year, might be just a leaf, or might be a flower fully developed, or might even be a flower that has been had its blossom time, even on the same day. Because remember, we have the time shift. We go back maybe 2 months on one day. So they need to be able to detect their plant, and then in the field they need to refind it and take notes. So every 100 meters of elevation, we take the notes. So this is very methodologically. So that's what the botanists do. We have a weather group. We call them weather group. Of course, they're not only measuring weather. They also measure chemical data. Soil is a very important factor of how the plants develop during the year. Also, exposition. It makes a big difference, especially in the mountains, if it's a meadow that goes south or is facing north, or if there's big rocks in the area that reflect the light and reflect the heat. also snow coverage, and in all sorts of abiotical factors. So we have those two groups, and in the beginning, those two groups don't know very much what the other group is doing. You know, they are trained independently. And of course, as university people, we are interested in the effects of our teaching. And I'm working in a self-determination theory, both for the creation of those projects, but also from a research perspective in the evaluation. So I believe strongly that autonomy support of the children who want to learn something is very important. You need them to do things by themselves, find out things by themselves. Of course, you cannot say, try. It will not work, especially not if you have a limited time. You need to support them in order to perceive autonomy. This is the art of education, I think. Make students believe that they discover it themselves in a limited period of time. And then, of course, they need feedback circles of competence. And not starting on Sunday, and the first feedback they receive is on Friday. They will not be activated during that time. You need short circuits of competences. So from 10 minutes to the whole week, or even further. So that's something you need to create. And, of course, they only learn if they feel well. So you need to concentrate on relations. There are two kinds of relations, teacher-student relations and student-student relations. So you need both addressed in an active way. And then, according to the theory, if you put those three ingredients into the equation, you will get a maximum intrinsic rate. And this is what we want. We want them to be intrinsically motivated. They need to be eager to learn. They're not being assigned something they have to do. And it works, I will show you. So the botanists, they have guiding questions. How do I find my plants in the field? So I need to know something about it. And what does it tell me about its environment? So is there any neighbor plants? Are there plants or shorties I can see? You know, I maybe have to talk to the other group that, you know, has other plants. I need to know a little bit about abiotic factors and about plant phenology, so how does it look over the year. So we start in the lab. We are well equipped, so the students can actually use equipment they are not so used in school. And also when they go in the field, they have these called the field bags. So it's three students or four students are assigned one field bag, and it's packed with equipment that costs probably 1,500 euros. So really good equipment that works. And this is sponsored by the Bosch Foundation, so we have actually the money to do this. So we measure a lot of abiotic factors, as I told you, and the landscape ecologists and meteorologists learn about weather and climate and what it means. They learn about, you know, things they can measure on the elevation. And they learn, most importantly, how the weather and the climate shape the land. Because this is very important to understand, to correlate the data. They need to know what happened there over the last 20,000 years since the last ice age. And they need to know the specifics of a certain spot on the landscape. So they also start in the lab, they learn about pressure, they also construct their own measurements tools. So to understand the science behind the tool, it's always good to create your own. So that's what they do, and they collect data. And we have the special thing that in the national park, there's a number of official measurement points, and we can connect our computer into it and actually get the actual weather data and compare it to those the students have taken with their own tools. So we can actually also now introduce into science and how diverse science can be, especially if you measure something. We have three instruments and measure four different values. So some impressions of what the students do. We have those prepared sheets where they actually are a little guided to be systematic about their research. And when they come down into the valley again, we have the groups, and they work in their individual group. So first, they work in the botany group, in the meteorology group, and once we merge the groups, we don't do it in a big group, we do it in a small group, they need to talk. And then they understand why it is not a straight line, a regression line, as we would presume. It's a zigzag curve, and they can tell for each data point why it is above or below the straight line. So this is how science begins to work in the head of the children. So here's some pictures, and for the group, for the social development, the groups are more effective if they cooperate. And once they cooperate across the groups, the subgroups, they learn a lot about group values, and we facilitate that process too, which makes a lot, which we can actually measure. Here, we go in with a mixed methods approach. We take interviews, we take notes, and here's some outputs of the words. Most importantly, excuse me, this one is interesting, that if you ask the children and let them tell about, you know, classroom experience and outdoor experience, they would say many more negative words about the classroom experience than in the outdoor experience, and vice versa. Many more positive words in the outdoor context than in the classroom context, which actually can deemed statistically highly significant. And this also goes together with regression plots of psychometric data, where we can see that competence, autonomy, and student-teacher relations have significant impact on the overall change or increase of motivational behavior. So SDI is an overall measure of motivational behavior. And if you want to measure the difference between the classroom context and the outdoor context, you have to see a difference. And if you calculate the regression of the increase of competence, autonomy, and student-teacher relations to the difference of overall motivation, you can see the same pattern all over all categories. Interesting that we cannot achieve a statistically higher student-student relation within that 1 week. That's interesting. Maybe we have to focus more on this. But we see that competence accounts for exactly the same as three times as much as autonomy and student-teacher relations. So there's something to learn from this, that actually it works. And that we are not only doing science, but that they also have fun and, you know, get some exercise and some adventure can be seen from those pictures. And we conclude we should take the children out for learning and confront them with nature and actually teach them what nature has to tell us.
Thank you very much for your presentation. We have a lot of time, but before I give questions to the audience, I have two practical to give us a bit more information for, we could see it from the pictures, but how old usually do people are and how often do you do it? So yeah. It's like, because you said it's in a different parts of the year, mm-hmm. So to...
Yes. Then. So the programs are designed for children from fourth class. So actually it's primary school and up to 12th graders. So, and we have done it, I have now, those were data-based on more than 320 observations. So we do it about 10 weeks per year. And the biggest part of the children that come are 12 to 14. Mm-hmm. This is it fits best in the German school system in that period. Mm-hmm. The smaller children, the parents in the schools are a little bit afraid to get that high up. Mm-hmm. It works well, but you know it's a culture thing. Mm-hmm. And I have one program now with 12th graders. I work with one class for a whole school year, actually one and a half school years, and we are not going on a short-term intervention, but it's a project where we actually use that approach to compare the German Alps and Norwegian Alps. So we have the space for time approach, not only vertically, but also horizontally. Going north is the same as going up. Mm-hmm. And this is also supported by the Robert Ross Foundation with a lot of money, and we set out on two research expeditions this summer. In June, we go to the Alps for a week, and in July, we go to Norway for 2 weeks and measure, you know, all those parameters. And Professor Annette Nenzel, she's actually IPCC lead author and Peace Nobel laureate in 2007 with the IPCC. At our university, she's supporting this kind of research. So I'm working very closely with her as a climate researcher. And the data we get from the students also go into her research. So we are setting up right now a sort of a citizen science approach. So this is growing. And I have also developed winter programs, but not in climatology, but wild year hibernation in snow. So we learn all about snow physics, and how the isolating factor of snow can be good for animals, but the different layers of snow causing avalanches and can also be a danger. So this is a different approach to wild deer ecology.
Thank you. So please, questions, comments.
For a distinct presentation, I have a question. Do you suppose that your knowledge, your results will be shared through normal education process? It seems to be like a research.
Yeah.
Not a big laboratory, outside of laboratory experiment.
Yes.
This result to be shared with the society, the other communities.
I understand the problem, and it's exactly the problem I was facing when my idea of outdoor teaching in German schools was frustrated by the German school system. So I decided to use a little window to get into the schools, which is the annual residential go. So, and I wanted to show with my research that it works. And it's a much better way to teach science combined with indoors. So this was to kick the door open. And it actually kicked two doors open. I'm now working with a primary school that wants to completely use the Danish system of Uniteskole, outdoor school, to have one school day per week assigned to outdoor teaching. Not doing outdoor sports or, you know, recreation, doing real stuff, curriculum based. So one elementary school has opened the doors, and one gymnasium actually has opened the doors. And I have just been through the first year in a study program, and there I was lucky to work together with neurologists. And we have the data right now we measured the cortisol levels of the school year, and we measured also the effects on the brain. So I scanned the children before the school year and the brains of the children after the school year in an MRT. And we had a control group in the same school. And we have significant support for our hypothesis that those children being taught outdoors have a better stress resilience and way lower stress levels during the school year than the children in the control group. Now we have the data. So this kind of research, which is very high, you know, cost intensive and everything, I admit it's an elite project, accessible for everyone, but we pay for it. I have put in 400,000 euros into this, just supporting the children. A normal university couldn't do that. I've been working on this for the last 4 years, and it costs me about 100,000 per year to maintain it. It's very expensive, but you know the money's out there, you just need to pick it up. The university has not spent a cent on it. It's all third-party money. Except for my salary, the university hasn't paid anything. So this is all privately funded.
Thank you. So, may I ask you about collaboration with National Park Administration? Because I think that's important.
Yes, we work with the Nationalpark Berchtesgaden. Also, in a research project we are setting up right now with Boston University and the Chinese Academy of Science. We want to use that. We want to use that model in the public available thing. So we are producing a smartphone application, which we want to give to the hikers in the national parks. And the app is designed in a way that it has a high entertainment level for the hikers, and they can use the app and send the data of flowers, offsprings. To a big data set, and we also want to include schools, and if there's interest from other national parks to participate, I'd be happy to share information and include this. We are still looking for money, so we were not successful in the first round with the Belmont Forum, which is a big global organization, but we will work on this, keep working, because the partners are really good. And I think the idea is also good, and more partners might maybe improve this. So I'd be happy to share information with you.
Thank you. Please.
Well, it's a really fantastic experiment, but I have a very practical question about the safety rules. How many persons for the group?
So we have two hunters keeping up the wolves. No, as I told, I have created a study program at our university. It's a short-term study program going over two semesters as an add-on. And I educate every year 15 students with the skills to lead children in the mountains and teach on a high academic level and teach on a high pedagogical level. So it's kind of the best of our students get this chance to be educated in this way. So I have 15 students I can distribute over the whole year, and as part of their study assignment, they need to take internships. So I don't pay them, of course. So they are in the courses and learn how to teach. So we have one grown up, one adult with four children, and you can send them in the mountains. So no child is alone in the mountains, no way. Yeah? And sometimes they stay overnight on bivouacs, so they have real adventure. And I have also researched that kind of adventure impact and the socializing impact. It is interesting that boys want to be pushed high. You know, they have they have heartbeats up to 190 during the hike. And they like that, and they need that, and they perform better if they have it on an average. And we have the group, we have the girls, they don't like that particularly. They like to be on a steady pace, not so much physical impact, but more social impact. So the girls perform better if they have a good social support. That's something we found out in our research I didn't focus on today. So actually we also need to gender our approaches a little bit. So I don't value this, I just have the data and tell them, well, don't break the boys, let them run, it's fine. And don't push the girls, it's fine. Let them have their own pace and choose it. Of course you have these exceptions to the rule. So that's something the pedagogue needs to take care of with his or her eyes and not from the statistics. But in general, that's a pattern that we can see. So safety is, we have strong safety protocols.
So last comment, question.
I'd be happy to share any information. You can contact me and I can record with me. So I'd be happy to cooperate.
Thank you very much. Okay, please. As we ended a bit earlier, so we would like to have like the last final discussion on any topic that you want to discuss in a very informal way. So please take a coffee inside, so that we're just have a coffee, water, and so on. And so we would like you, if you would like to stay for a while more with us, take a coffee, water, biscuit, and we can discuss anything, any topic.
Yeah. Maybe